title of the talk is Reaching a Consensus in a Dynamically Changing Environment. And this, much of what I'm going to talk about reflects joint research with my student, Min Cao, and with Brian Anderson, who I understand gave a talk here on Heterogeneity Theory 2 years ago, right after he left Yale University. That is also a topic of I collaborate with him quite a bit. But that, so those of you who are circling around graphs, there are two kinds of graph theory. There's graph theory for sissies, and there's graph theory for tough people. And what Anderson talked about is graph theory for tough people, it's combinatory and stuff like that. It's the scary part. What I'm going to talk about is graph theory for sissies, which is what's sometimes called algebraic graph theory or spectral graph theory, and it is an elegant topic. Very nice monographs on it. So the next thing I want to say is I gave a version of this talk a week ago in Los Angeles, and this was a Los Angeles was close to Hollywood, and naturally everybody came with the very best videos. And so my talk was later in the weekend, and I said to myself, how am I going to match up all these great videos of Francesco Bullo and some Swedish guys over the test to some. Not search, but coverage problems, how do you spread out a bunch of conversations in the plane to cover a large area, and Eric Just, who I know you know was there, and give it to where he was going around in circles, and I was starting to get a little intimidated, so I decided that I should come with my own movie. Warming that you, I suppose, ought to be into things like stampeding. And there's more to the story. It turns out that the this particular video was generated using ideas which have their roots with a computer scientist. I can show the rest of the movie and stop. I talk. this fellow Craig Reynolds in 1987 wrote a paper in which he generated, came up with three rules for moving points in the plane, and I'll talk to you about those rules briefly in a second. And these are two animators who might say he's in the graphics industry, and now I'm not talking about the mathematical graphs, but the kind that everybody knows about. And these particular animations are from his webpage. You might want to click on it. And he wrote a paper on voids, V-O-I-D-S. Now, I know that a lot of people here are not from the United States and don't understand when I say that voids means it must be from Brooklyn. But if you are in the United States all at once, that's a way of talking to them, they try to say words, they say void. So I think that must have been his mind. Anyway, what does Reynolds' work have to do with what I'm going to talk about? Let me give you a better bit of a story. Here's a picture of a void. You see it's a triangle, and the triangle has a sensing radius about it, and the void, bunch of voids, moving the plane, and they're all moving at the same speed, and in order to generate, oh, I should have mentioned that Reynolds' work was pretty heavy duty, eventually got him an Academy Award. So very highly regarded in the animation industry. Reynolds was concerned about how do you keep those triangles from all bunching together and from all spreading apart, and how do you keep them all moving in the same direction, and how, so if you look at his paper, what we find are three rules. There are no equations in his paper, it's all algorithms without equations, just some found a separation rule which keeps the points and voids apart, an alignment rule which has them all moving in the same direction, and a cohesion rule, those are his words, which have them all not flying too far apart. And what does that have to do with this talk? Well, what I'm going to do is to focus on one rule, namely the alignment rule, because that, you might say, is the central topic of this talk about the census. Now, as it turns out, you might think that this paper was published in 1987, that we discovered the paper and then went on to do some analysis of it. Well, history was not quite like that. Instead, what happened in the mid-1990s, full 10 years later, is that my student, Archer G. Lynn, who was working on cooperative control and had a background in physics, was looking at physical review letters and ran across this particular paper by Tomas Vysok and co-authors. And I'm going to explain to you in a minute what Vysok did. And it was only after the fact that we realized, and other people as well, that Vysok's idea is the alignment rule that Craig Reynolds had come up with a decade earlier. So what exactly did this do? He simulated a flock of N agents, which he called particles, as a physicist, all moving in the plane at the same speed as the different headings, theta 1, 2, theta s. Each agent's heading is updated at the same time as the rest, using a local rule based on the average of its own current heading plus the headings of its neighbors. So what this did was to demonstrate that these nearest neighbor rules will cause all agents to eventually move in the same direction, despite the absence of a leader or centralized coordination. And what we did was to give a theoretical explanation of why this could happen. Paper that I referred to is the Transactions of Automatic Control, published 2 years ago. So let's go in a little bit further detail. Maybe I should give you a brief outline of what we're going to talk. I'm going to talk today about two different topics. The topics are, I'm going to talk a little bit about convergence rates. That's a little bit airy. That's a bit. And I'm going to secondly talk about what happens if you look at a version of this problem in which no two agents have the same kind of clock in common, and there's a synchronization issue? How do you analyze the problem in that particular setting? And so those are the two sub-issues I'm going to talk about, and there is a overriding message, and that message is that graphs are something really worth thinking a lot about in the formulation of problems in system theory. This is despite the fact that graphs have been around forever and a major part of circuit analysis and computer science. They have not really penetrated the systems engineering field in a big way until fairly recently, and I'm pleased to see that that is now happening. And one of the reasons one of the specific points about graphs I'd like to make is that sometimes one's interested in properties of non-negative matrices, in particular whether there are elements in the matrix which are there or there's zeros. And quite obviously, if that's all that's of interest in the matrix, there is a graphical way of talking about that fact. And why would you prefer to use the graphs rather than the matrix? Well, if you take the point of view, as I have, that matrices were invented for people who hate numbers, and that were, and so that what does matrix enable you to do? It enables you to manipulate in your mind a whole array of numbers using a single symbol. The computer must get into the arithmetic of the details of simultaneous equations, but matrices allow you to think at a higher level. That's the real power. And if you have to get into the details and innards inside the matrix in a way, you're missing the point. And, well, if all you care about is the zero and non-zero pattern in the matrix, then maybe it's a graph that you are thinking about, and my last bit of religion spreading at this point is that the graph is worth the past matrix. Okay, so, or something like that.
Okay, so what did Bishop do? Now, first of all, I should mention some other work. There's been a lot of good papers. Luke Morrell, Randy Beard, David and Jelly, Mrs. Blondell, who I guess is coming down here to talk about something a little different. And a lot of good papers, and this seems to be a quite popular topic these days, judging by the workshop. Okay, so here's the picture. Here you have an agent in the plane, has a sensing radius, we'll say R sub I, positive number, and at current time, any other agents which happen to be in this closed district are defined to be the neighbors of agent I. Simple idea. We'll take the point of view that each agent is a neighbor of itself. And then what Visit did was to, all the agents are moving at the same speed s, so the issue is, what about the headings or the headings? And what he did was he considered a simple update rule, which looks something like this, very, very simple-minded. Script n sub I of t is a set of indices of agent I's neighbors at time t, and n sub I is just the number of neighbors at time t. So what this is an average. So it's heading average. Okay. So if you think about it a little bit, you say, well, gee, you've got an equation like that. Maybe you want to do this to represent neighbor relationships graphically. And so one way to do this is to write down a bunch of integers, which we'll call vertices to the graph, just as many as there are agents to talk about, and then define a graph. The directed graph. Directed graphs are graphs which have arrows between vertices rather than just lines. I define a directed graph with vertex at B and arcs at script A of T, which is defined so that JI is an arc, if J is a neighbor of I. J is a neighbor of I. Simple idea. So here is a representation of two vertices, J and I, and I've drawn the arrow to indicate that J is a neighbor of I. Or say differently, I can see J, or I is receiving the sense data from J. So here's an example of such a graph, and you'll notice that all the vertices have self-arcs. And the reason for the self-arcs is because of the assumption that every agent is a neighbor of itself. And that it turns out to be technically a very important consideration. So you also see that arc from 1 to 2 is made of 1, 2. All vertices are self-arcs. And in the talk, I'm be talking quite a bit about the set of all directed graphs, the vertex at B, and self-arcs of all vertices. Why do we need to worry about this whole big set? Because as the agents move around in the plane, neighbors change. And so that means the graph which is appropriate 3 o'clock in the afternoon may not be the same graph which is appropriate at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, so we're going to have to worry about all these different graphs. These particular graphs are especially nice because they have sort of a real geometric interpretation. It turns out there are other graphs associated with these problems which have less geometric interpretation. Okay, even though I said neighbors is the best thing in the world, it is useful at some point to make the connection between the graph and the matrix. And the connecting point is typically the adjacency matrix, which is a very simple idea. It's a matrix of ones and zeros defined in such a way that Aij is equal to 1 if I is a neighbor of J. The other matrix I want to write down is the diagonal matrix, whose the nice thing with the diagonal matrix is diagonal is a valence, way in degree, as it's filling it now, Ei is the degree of vertex I, what is the degree? You just count the number of arcs incident are coming into a particular vertex. So for vertex 7, there's an in degree of 1. For vertex 6, there's an in degree of 2. Why introduce these matrices? Because they are critical to the state-space model for the agent system we've been talking about. So how do you use state-space systems? First, I should remind you that the update equation looks like this for each of the agents, each agent in the neighbor set. It turns out that if we introduce the state vector in the absolutely most obvious way, that the state equation is describing the system looks like this, would be the versus the reverse of the dipole matrix of the integers of gravity. A is the primary transpose of A is the basis of it. Okay, so we'll move that up there. Now, if you look at that, you recognize right away that this is a switch leading system. So, if you come out of the world of hybrid systems theory, you say, hey, it's a switch system, and it works, and it's a and which is something that we tried to do for a while, just defined existing ideas of switch system theory to absolutely nowhere. Okay, obviously these matrices have structure, one wants to think about them. So let me use the symbol F to denote any such matrix. Each graph is exactly one matrix. And against my wishes and better judgment, but because of my various co-authors, I've agreed to call these things flocking matrices. So each graph determines a flocking matrix, so there's a way to go back the other way as well. So and anyway, here's the updated equations for the heading vector, simple. And so, obviously, if you want to understand what's going on, we're going to have to explore the properties of these matrices in some detail. The first thing one recognizes is that the entries in these matrices are all non-negative because we're multiplying two matrices of numbers which are non-negative, and that property is preserved in the multiplication. The other thing, which is a little less obvious, but not infinitely impossible to understand, is that if you add up the elements in any one row, you get the number one. And the reason for that comes about from this averaging rule. It's not so hard to convince yourself that it's true. These two properties alone distinguish that and put it in a certain category. Matrices with these properties have the name stochastic, and they have, in particular, a number of interesting properties, but one of them is that because of condition two, F always has an eigenvector of 1s and an eigenvalue of 1. That's always the case. That is that's property. There are other things as well. So we're going to be a little bit worried about norms. And one of the places that we want to stray in trying to understand the systems like this, we're trying to do everything hoping we would do to study stability, is look for a quadratic component function. Quadratic component functions are like putting around peg in a square hole for this problem. There's an action because component functions and norms are very much the same thing. And a quadratic component function corresponds to a two norm. And for this problem, the norm that works real well is an infinity norm. So why is that the case? So remember what the infinity norm turns out to be for not. Generally, the infinity norm of the induced infinity norm of a square matrix is obtained by taking the absolute values of all the entries in the matrix, adding up the elements in any one row, that gives you a number, you get n numbers, and the largest of that is a real norm, and it's called the infinity norm. Now, in this case, the good news, the numbers are already non-negative, so we don't need the absolute values, so we almost got a linear kind of a norm if we stick with the infinity norm. And moreover, because all the row sums of a stochastic matrix are the same, the infinity norm and the value 1, the infinity norm of a stochastic matrix is 1. And this is an induced norm, so it's a multiplicative, that means the norm of the product of two matrices is the product of the matrices. And all that's cool stuff because it's what allows one to carry out, one of the ways one can carry out a conversion analysis, and in fact, not just that, but also conversion rate analysis. So the flocking matrices being a special class of stochastic matrices all have infinity norms of 1. So move that to the top. Okay. We'd like to analyze the system. Well, that's pretty clear what you've got to do. You expand it out in the obvious way. And the problem with deciding, what we're trying to do is to find conditions under which the all the headings go to the same value, if that's reaching a consensus. That boils down to determining conditions under which the product of these matrices, as p goes to infinity, converges to a vector of 1s times a row vector of c. studying, finding out when.
Since the stochastic matrices are called closed level multiplication, this applies to a product of stochastic matrices as well. So if what you're interested in is in a product converging to a rank one matrix, then the product, the double floor product, has to go to zero. And that turns out to be something which is very easy to understand, what's required in order for that to be true. And the notes that I think are available here go into that and explain it, and it's really quite simple. But we're going to take a slightly different approach today because we're interested in convergence rates. So there's a second decomposition, a little bit less useful, but important for what I have to say today, which is to break any stochastic matrix up as 1 times roof S minus roof, double roof S, or both roof S and roof double S are non-negative matrices, and define the solid slot.
could add up these two non-negative matrices, these are square matrices, and get, I don't know what you call it, I think form of S. And let's notice that double floor S is going to be less than or equal to floor roof S. And here I'm using a partial ordering set one matrix less than two non-negative matrices. This one less than or equal to this one. This one minus this one is an non-negative matrix. So it produces a partial ordering on the matrix. So that's the way it makes sense. We can show rather easily that for any two stochastic matrices, S1 and S2, that one has this inequality. This is the key to the grade analysis that I want to talk about. This number is a scalar, which is easily computable, as you can see. It's just a very simple number. It has a name. It's called scattering, scrambling constant. And we'll have a little more to say about that. So, the same applies, since stochastic matrices are closed under multiplication, the composition also applies to a product. So we get 1 times a row vector plus a something looks like that. And it's this thing we want to make statements about what happens to this as the number of terms in the product goes to infinity. The rate at which this might go to zero is the convergence rate. So, by iterating, this step is a little bit hard to follow, but it's actually very easy to do. By trying to push. Anybody a little funny? This term, which is the satisfies this inequality, and you can see that if these numbers mu are all less than 1, and we keep getting that, this thing on the right is going to go to 0, and that means this is going to go to 0. And that's good news because from using this fact, we get an inequality that looks like this. And so if this goes to 0, I bring you back to this equation, this is going to 0, and we're ending up with a product over a rank 1 matrix. So the whole story is embedded, is basically tied up in this going to 0, and you can see that how fast it's going to 0 will be related to the product, how fast the product moves goes to 0. So the infinity norm can be brought in here, and I'm talking from the infinity norm, which is easy to go from here to here. So ultimately, the moral of the story is that we want to focus on these scattering constants and what happens to products. Okay. I think I can get eggs. That's it.
So can you go back into the scrambling position?
Yeah, it's right there. It should be. Is that
okay? No. It's too slight time.
It's a little bit cryptic, but it's clear that it's easily computable.
Yeah. the minimum of Sik, it is just a two number, right?
What
take the minimum of Sik is Ak.
Yeah,
and then you sum up what the minimum.
Right, that's right.
Take one on this. I haven't seen this before. And yeah. I've seen your talk, but not. But then there are.
I'll talk more about this later. I'd have to evaluate this thing from the data of matrices.
This is not. This is a similar truth. It's not.
Yes,
it's not a. Certainly not. All right. Okay. So the conclusion of this little discussion is basically this, but is a even broader recap. We're looking. Trying to find out what happens to this recursion equation, then the theta vector converges to a range of two of something like this, for all the headings converge to the same value that theta says. And the rate at which that happens is tied up with the rate at which, if convergence happens at all, it's tied up with the rate at which this product of scalars converges to zero. And this is the square root. So I said before that graphs are an issue. So how do we make the transition here from matrices to graphs? Because we're talking about stochastic matrices. So there's a simple way of doing this. For any stochastic matrix, in fact, any non-negative matrix, you can define the graph of the matrix just to be that graph which has an arc from I to j if the ij to ji element of the matrix is non-zero. I can't remember which, but you get the idea. That's the precise definition in terms of cases. It means the same thing. So there's a well-defined simple function which assigns to any non-negative matrix, including stochastic matrices, a graph. The graph is directed, and in our case it is self-arcs because the stochastic matrices we're looking at have positive values. In general, if you were to compute the graph of a Fock matrix, it would have been the neighbor graph which determined the Fock matrix. So that's good news. And so convergence, the point that I want to make here is that in this problem and all the problems that we've looked at, there's been a handful of different kinds of problems, convergence and worst case convergence rates for this problem can be decided completely in terms of graphs without reference to stochastic matrices with the average of the light. Well, that's not completely true, I guess, with convergence rates, but it's why is that useful? In addition to the fact that graphs are vectorial and convey a lot more information than a big array of numbers, there's another reason. It's especially important because it allows one to consider consensus problems which are nonlinear. If you get the graphs that are relevant, then the underlying dynamics have a chance anyway to expand the dynamics from linear dynamics to something nonlinear. This indeed has already been done. Very nice paper by Tanit Chakravarti and George Pappas, which explains Craig Reynolds' Academy Award winning algorithm. This is a nice piece of work, which is sort of escaped from public. Okay, so that's another reason for going to graphs. Okay, now, once you're into the world of graphs, then the next thing one wants to worry about is classes of graphs, because we haven't said anything about the specific kinds of Flocky matrices correspondingly. If you want to do them, each Flocky matrix has a graph associated with it. Some graphs are nicer than others. So I'm going to talk first about a very simple idea, which I'll call a neighbor-shared directed graph. A neighbor-shared directed graph is a directed graph in which each pair of distinct vertices share a common neighbor. Now, the neighbor of a vertex is any vertex from which there is an arc. So this guy's a neighbor of me if there's an arc from him to me. A neighbor shared graph. So here's an example of a neighbor shared graph. And if you look at it for a second, you can see, for example, vertex 2 and 4 share vertex 4. They both have vertex 4 as a neighbor. And so restricted class of graphs. Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about worst-case convergence rate for Flocky matrices in which the graphs that are being counted along the way are neighbor-shared. We'll start with that, working up to the general result. So here's a floppy matrix, there's the graph, this is the matrix, just review. Okay, so the point that the first point that I want to make is that since all the diagonal elements of the matrix are bounded above by n, remember n is the number of vertices, and each ki is the number of incoming arcs. So that's very clear, that must be true. That means that all, if you look at the formulas, all the non-zero elements of the matrix must satisfy this particular problem. It's a crude estimate. Okay, so we'll focus on that. Supposing the graph is named shared. So this, what that means is that there's distinct vertices I and J, and they must have a neighbor. What that means is that the ikth and jkth elements of the matrix must be non-zero. And therefore, applying our inequality, we reach the inevitable conclusion that there are these two inequalities. So starting with this, you then can conclude that this particular sum satisfies this inequality. Don't try to follow this conclusion. I'm going to go fast. And from this, a little, just almost no thinking at all, but more than for the talk, you get the formula for the scattering constant, you get an inequality from that. So what this does is it tells you the scrambling constant. It tells you that the scrambling constant is always bounded above by this particular number for any neighbor shared graph. And so that gives the smaller the scrambling constant, the faster the convergence rate. So if this, in a way, is a worst case bound. If we're stepping through a sequence of neighbor shared graphs, then we know the convergence rate is going to be this, or it's going to be bounded above this. Things are going to go down no slower than this to the whatever power is, depending on the inverse of the product. The question which one might ask is, how conservative is this? How tight is this bound? It turns out that you can show that for more than three agents, it's very tight. All this does is give you an example, which I'm not going to take even the time to read, but in this particular example, the scrambling constant, in fact, achieves its bound of 1 minus 1. So it's a tight bound. So summary, every infinite product of n by n flocking matrices and neighbor shared graphs converges to rank one matrix at a rate no slower than 1 minus 1. And moreover, the okay, now, neighbor shared graphs are a rather restricted family of graphs. So we'd like to go to a bigger, more general family of graphs. So the family that I will talk about briefly are called rooted graphs. So a root, a directed graph, is a vertex for which there is, for each other vertex, there is, in the graph, is a directed path for an I and j. If you prefer to think in terms of spanning trees, the root is the root of a spanning tree, and the graph has a spanning tree. It is not, but the graph can have cycles. So here's an example of a rooted graph. There's the root, which you can get from vertex 2 to any other vertex of the graph. Anybody will agree, at least I think you will, that this is pretty easy to visualize. Believe me, if I start trying to tell you what a rooted graph looks like in terms of a matrix, it's not so easy to understand what's going on. There's even better examples of this. Some people call the Sarre model matrices, which are totally crooked, but the graphs turn out to be rooted graphs. So the graphs really tell a big story that the matrices tell. So a rooted graph is a direct graph from each point of root. Any neighbor shared graph turns out to be rooted. That has to be proven. So rooted graphs is the bigger class. They're more rooted than the right neighbor shared. Okay, next thing we're going to need, so we have all these graphs, we're going to have combinational rules. We're going to have to talk about combining. I mean, look at the literature. The combinational rule that you're going to see, which comes from the undirected graph case, is union. So the two graphs of the same vertex set, you can form by the union, you mean you create a graph of the same vertex set whose arcs are the union of the arc sets of the two graphs you start with. That's the union. Simple idea. Turns out, even though that is a very useful idea, it doesn't instead of combining graphs using union, we can combine it using composition. So I'll say the composition of a graph G1 with G2, written G2 circle G1, is then the details of this formula are too fast for the talk. But basically what it boils down to is that a graph of the product of two non-negative vectors, stochastic or not, is equal to the composition of the graphs. That's where the concept comes from. But the connection between composition and union, and there is a connection, it's important because the main results on the classical flocking problem are stated in terms of union, but they're absolutely entirely equivalent statement in terms of composition also exists with regards to the question of the purpose. Okay, it's a fact that the composition of n minus 1 and more rooted graphs is neighbor shared. That's a fact that we use. Since it's 10 o'clock, I think I'm getting worried a little bit.
We started late, so.
Oh, okay. Did I really want to talk a little bit about the second part of the talk.
No, go ahead.
I think what I'm going to do, unless my host's screaming, is to jump fast forward to the beyond this. Let me just say that one can, using the notion of rooted, get convergence rate estimates for rooted graphs instead of neighbor shared. When you're done doing this, you end up with rate estimates that look like that. You can also get conservative rate estimates for.
That's the summary for
rooted graphs. But you can also look at strongly connected graphs and get a formula that looks like that. Strongly connected graphs are more special than rooted graphs. A rooted graph is you got one particular vertex from which you get to any other vertex. Strongly connected means from any pair of vertices you get from one to the other. So there's a strongly connected is actually quite a strong statement. But there are results, and anybody interested in this at a slower rate, just pick up the last CDC. This is a paper. Okay. So what I want to do next, in the last few minutes, is talk about something with these brand new results that just worked out 2 weeks ago when we should have been writing our CDC papers. Instead, we were working out the research. I should be preparing this talk, I should say. I was doing the research with my students to set up an asynchronous clocking problem. We did get that done, and then we prepared to talk with them overnight in California, so it was sleeping. That's the way it goes, you know? Okay, so let's go back. Let's go back and look at the missing problem. Same slide as before. Except I emphasize something. In the missing algorithm, we get all these NHs, they're all using the cycle tool and update their hand, they're all doing it at the same time. That means they've got a common clock. They know. What happens if each HE updates independent of the rest according to the tone clock? How do you even analyze this? That's an asynchronous system. That's what I want to talk a little bit about. This is a completed piece of work I'm only going to be able to use part of the picture. So there are just a little bit of the game that I had before. So the first thing I want to do is to formulate the problem. That takes a little time. Then, I want to introduce a concept, I'm going to tell you the results, and then I want to introduce a concept called analytic synchronization, which is a way of taking an asynchronous system and embedding it in a synchronous system so you can apply your favorite convergence techniques. And then I want to just barely point to the issues involving graphs that arise in this problem and how they might go concept. Okay, so the first thing is to talk about the update rules more specifically. So what's happening is that each agent, as you think about it, is generating a sequence of event times. And we're going to assume that the difference between successive event times of any agent is bounded above and below uniformly. And we're not going to assume that the event times are in space for any agent, and we're not going to assume that the event times are synchronized in any way between agents. So the update, take this through more carefully to get the right formulation. So update goes something like this. At time tik, H9 updates computes its waypoint, a number. by using the average. Just like before. So it looks at its neighbors, it sees their headings, and its average. Just like before. And then after it computes it on a time interval between its kth and kth plus first event time, it updates its heading. In other words, it would not be the least bit concerned about how that is actually carried out. But we will need some data about that interval, because this is a synchronous problem. It comes with the problem formulation. So we're going to assume, this is going to be the assumption that one's going to make. It's not a particularly severe one. It just says that when the heading is updated by the interval t i plus 1 k, there is the amount of deviation that the agents allowed to go through is bounded, uniformly bounded by a constant times the difference between the computed value of its kth waypoint and whether it is in fact k. In particular, if the waypoint is the same as the point that it's at, then it doesn't change at all. That's the assumption. No, not for the heading. The heading can change
position.
Oh, it's just a graphical way of saying that there is a change in the age over this period of time from this value to this value. That's all.
So you decided to do this one?
Yeah. So you think this time problem. So if you're looking in some books, computer science books, we did a couple of control studies, we've tried to tackle problems where the synchronization is involved. You know, a lot of these problems are a bit of a cheat because they start with an underlying clock. In computer science, there's always an underlying clock. Computer science thinks in a discrete world. So there's an underlying clock, and then there are processes which are evolving asynchronously with respect to that clock. Sounds a little crazy, but it is possible to formulate problems. Those problems are a little bit easier to conceptualize at the outset than this. Okay. Picture's worth a thousand words. So here's the story of what's going on. So theta I, how agent computes a waypoint. That's his waypoint. And then he moves for that, the heading to that waypoint. And that defines his next event time. So that event time could be pre-specified, or could be the time it takes to get to the next waypoint, your choice. Having done that, he computes his next waypoint and then moves there. And you notice the heading is the picture is changing continuously. And then this process is completed. So what happens is a sequence of waypoints is generated, a heading trajectory is generated. And what we want to do is to convert that into a form which is useful for our purposes. So turns out it's possible to define a function u, which has these properties I'm going to show you the picture of what's going on here. U is not going to be continuous. And the reason that u exists is because of the assumption which is right about it. There's a picture of what u looks like. And it's possible to define u in such a way that theta can also be shown to satisfy this updated equation. And that is the one which we're going to work with. Now it is possible to combine the two updated equations, which are shown at the top, into a single equation, like this, and that's very familiar. That's the missing updated equation. Except, this formula tells us how theta I evolve only on agent I's event time set. But to use this formula, we need to know values of theta j's event times. So this formula, this formula is all you need in the synchronous case. In the asynchronous case, it does not tell the whole story, and we can't use it as it stands. The asynchronous case, what we first of all need is a common time scale for the system. So here's how we do this. Let script t denote the set of event times of all the agents. And we relabel the elements of this set in an ascending order, T0, T1. So there's a picture of what I just described. So the agents are interacted by the averaging board. Each is generating a set of event sensors. And the first thing that I want to do, I need to do this to just take results, is to combine these into a single sequence, keeping track of which ones go with which agents, and in addition, relabeling the elements in the set. Something like this. Okay. Now, so then what else? We need one more thing before I can state the results. We need to talk about neighbors. Right now, neighbors neighbors are defined at all times for H and I, but it turns out that the only meaningful neighbors for H and I are those in event times, and it turns out to be more useful to redefine an agent's neighbors between these event times a little differently. So let's look, T sub I is set of event times with H and I, and we'll define a new neighbor set, which is the old one, as long as we're in event time with H and I. But if we're in between event times of H and I, we're just going to define its neighbor to be itself. And what's going on here, you'll see this in a minute, this is a reflection of the fact that between event times,
and this is like sampling the change you got.
Yes.
Only at event times.
Like that. It comes from the step that I learned in synchronization, but I needed to put this in first so I can state some results. The neighbor graphs are defined exactly the same way as before, and I won't go into that. That's just a reminder of what a rooted graph is. The next thing I want is the notion of a strongly rooted graph. Strongly rooted means it's an arc from one vertex to every other, whereas rooted means it's a path.
So that's one hole?
One hop. Exactly.
So it's one hop rooted.
One hop rooted, exactly. What puzzles are like, this is clearly not talking about this. These are, something by mistake, but this particular graph has three roots. If I add some more arcs, it becomes stronger. Show that every arc in either of two graphs, G1 and G2, is their composition G1 and G2 of soft arcs or vertices. Thus, the set of all directed graphs and many vertices with soft arcs in each vertex is closed by the composition. Two more definitions, and then here. A finite sequence of graphs is joined in the root if the composition is a rooted graph. So you might have a situation where the individual graphs encountered are not very well connected, they're not rooted. But if you compose them, you get a rooted graph. If that's true, we say they're rooted. We would like that to talk about what happens when that process repeats itself over and over again. And when it does, we say that an infinite sequence of graphs is repeated. Okay. These are the updated equations again about which I'm going to talk. As I said before, I can combine the two. And in the same in this case, I can replace the double subscript notation with single subscript notation and tell you what the main result, the convergence result is in the same in this case. Here is the theorem. It says that the original missing property in the same in this case has the property that all the headings converge to a common value if all of the neighbor graphs. If the sequence of neighbor graphs pattern along the way is repeatedly generated, that's the result of the several versions of this in the literature. What about the asynchronous case? Good news. For the asynchronous case, same formula, same statement is true. Now the graphs are different, but the theorem is the same. So what this is saying, roughly speaking, is that the introduction of asynchronous decision making by and large does not affect convergence. It, I'm sure, affects convergence rate, but not the issue of convergence itself. Since we're getting close to lunch time, I'm going to just make...
So what changes is the way you define the sequence of events?
There's several things have changed. First of all, the name notion of graph, of what the name of graph comes, has to change. And you have to introduce the underlying common time axis. And the next thing is to do what I call analytic synchronization, where we sort of summarize this. So what we have here, this particular concept, is we've applied this before to another problem, So imagine you have n mutually unsynchronized processes, p1, p2, pn together, constituting an asynchronous system. So they're all doing something, they're each generating their own, they're each looking at their own time scale and their own event times. So what the first step would be to understand such a system is to merge all the event time sequences into a single coordinate set T. We've already done that. Next step would be to define the neighbor of each HUD itself between event times. And we've done that. Next, we define the synchronized state of the P system at event times to be the original state, unsynchronized state of the system at those times, plus possibly some additional states. It might surprise you that you may have built the system up and these additional state variables. At times on the time axis between two successive event times of H and I, define the state of the P subsystem to be constant at the same value as the first two event times. So you don't just define it that way. And that is really the reason for introducing, say, the neighbor, H should be a neighbor of itself. And analyzing the result of the cyclic system, what we've done is we've defined the original system, P1, P2, are we trying on the time axis? What we do is define their behavior on the time axis of over there. And then we have to multiply the same time axis, and we get a synchronous system.
How is this going to work online?
Well, there's nothing to do, this is just analysis. Just analysis.
Because I don't find you one home.
So it's strictly analysis. We're not actually doing anything with this. And so let me just end my talk by showing you what the kind of thing that happens. So here, introducing new variables. They're kind of like the variables have bars on them, but they are really the heading and waypoint variables at H and I's event times and between H and I's event times. We just call them constant. That's the definition. And then you can prove that with some work that these particular variables that we just introduced satisfy recursion equations, which the details of these are not important. What's important is that these are, in fact, linear recursion equations, and they're defined for all time, not just on the event times of H and I. So you get a recursion equations like this for each agent, and you stack them up together, and you get yourself a discrete time system. And guess what? The matrix, the system ultimately you produce a state vector. The system ultimately looks like that. And the matrix is a stochastic matrix on the bottom of the slide. Now, this particular stochastic matrix is twice as big. It's 2n by 2n, because we've introduced extra state variables. So there is no longer the simple bijective relationship between this state matrix, this stochastic matrix, and the neighbor matrices. In fact, there's going to be a whole new set of graphs introduced, which are going to be the graphs of these stochastic matrices, and they're going to be graphs on 2n vertices rather than on n, with twice as many elements in the state vector. Yes.
There's a one assumption in the previous example. That's one of the process Pi takes the constant value of the first time event during the.
It's not an assumption, it's a definition.
It's a definition.
Yeah.
So what if we call some constraints, it's continuous variable?
this is a definition at my convenience just to make the analysis work. The actual theta is very continuously, and it is curved like that.
Okay.
So this is just a gimmick, it's a gadget, which makes it logical. I've got to figure out a way to explain this even more clearly. That's what's involved. So let me conclude by with these statements. What this is an example of a problem, and there's a lot involved in analytical synchronization, asynchronous to synchronous, but among other things, the original graph of n vertices somehow has led to 2n by 2n matrices, and thus graphs of 2n vertices, and worse still, these graphs don't have soft arcs. They have plenty of structure, they don't have soft arcs. And so the tools and techniques that work with graphs of n vertices with soft arcs don't work here, at least without further analysis. And so here's what the kind of graph that you would end up with. This would be a four-agent problem. You get 8 vertices because of the lifting. And so you need to introduce tools and techniques and ultimately deal with both graphs, big graph and little graph. And there is a relationship. You notice that there's a kind of bunching that you can do. Vertex 1 and 5 go together, 2 and 6 and so forth. And that what this is really is a partition of the 8 vertices with the disjoint non-overlapping sets, and everybody knows what that's called. That partition and partitions induce equivalence relations induce quotient sets, and sure enough, the corresponding to this theory is something called a quotient graph, and that quotient graph is nothing more than, for example, connecting vertex 1 to vertex 3. If there is an arc in the original graph from either 1 or 5 to either 3 or 7. This process of lifting the system and then quotienting it back down is not unique to this problem. There's another completely different flopping problem where exactly the same tool is used, and it does seem to be the natural tool. Notice that the quotient graph does have some flux. The quotient graph, by the way, is guess what? It is the neighbor graph associated with this algorithm. So I know this is very high speed, but it is something to think about when you're staring at stochastic matrices, which don't have all these properties you know and love. If you worry about quotient down, getting to smaller ones, going back to what they're related to the original problem. So that's basically the end of my talk. These were actually generated a few years ago by my student, and these are all various versions of Visick's problem. The original one on the upper left is really the Visick model without any gun to it. The one on the right shows that the agents can bifurcate if the agents, under certain conditions, if the sensing gradient are too small, that can happen. You can also have a follow-up version of the problem, which one agent ignores the rules and just goes, but none of the other agents know that. And the fourth one is the lower right, is kind of a microscopic view of the third one, in which you can see the red leader being followed, and you see that his neighbors in yellow are changing as the evolution of the system goes forward. Of course, to run these simulations, you've got to do more than I have told you about, because all the mathematics that I've been dealing with has told you, it says if you have, if you encounter a sequence of graphs, then you converge, but where does that sequence of graphs come from? That comes from the additional equations, which actually move points around the plane. So if you're stuck with building a simulation, like my students, then you've got to worry about what those equations might look like. And that is very much a nonlinear system because the switching signal which generates the graphs is related to where you actually are on the plane. And like is commonly done in adaptive control, you try to analyze systems like this, say what might happen under typical trajectories or under typical sequences of this. That makes the problem. The linear problem is a common trick which is done in the Swiss event control networks here as well. Thanks.
Thank you for a very nice answer. We probably get some questions.
Synchronous systems, because I mean, what was he adding in the
that first? Is the synchronous system.
No, that's not. But in the first synchronous system that you had, it was he that every node basically updated at the same time.
Yeah.
So all and every node was the neighbor of itself.
Yes.
Here suddenly you don't have that.
Right.
Right. So in effect, there's a much larger class of synchronous system without the property of having a self-loop.
Yes, that's true. That is correct.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. There are actually several of those. That's right.
But
let's say you could say I don't know anything about asynchronous. Here's another. I'm delivering you code.
Yeah.
The thing is that the stochastic matrices are so highly structured that somebody, you know, your grandmother would say, "Who cares? Where does that come from?" And you say, "Oh, it came from Lifton." Yeah. But you're right. What you're saying is correct.
What about the stochastic versions?
I haven't. Stochastic is giving me an upset stomach. But, no, I have nothing against them. It's just getting all that affliction I've always had. You know, thank God they passed up. You were around to deal with it. But it's obvious that I don't know what sort of stochastic, but there's certainly probabilistic versions of it. You could start asking questions about, you know, how likely is it that you would get a sequence of graphs like this? And this would get into probabilistic graphs. Done stuff like this, but actually, the missing problem is set of those stochastics.
The original problem had some random thing, but came from physics and background and stuff like that.
I mean, one of the questions the Swami meeting last week that came up was people from the physicists, they were worried about noise. And an approximately correct answer to that question is these systems exhibit exponential configurations, and so they have noise immunity. They're not going to grossly misbehave. But of course, that's only approximately true because these are not quite linear systems in the usual sense. And I don't know how the theory really goes when you move away from crystalline or linear systems.
There is some work on noise already, as you can see, in terms of the location of one precisely what happens. But in very small situations, it's very special.
So supposing you want to think carefully about what it means not to make a precise measurement.
Sure.
Because of the exponential convergence, we know that small changes in the
One question I wanted to ask you is, in these estimates that we get, which are tight, I assume that the tightness comes from some sort of quote-unquote worst type topology.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Has there been any studies of optimizing topology?
No, there's very, very little known about this. Okay. Almost nothing.
But when I optimize the topology so that I can speed up over.
That obviously that's important. Things get even worse, unfortunately, if you move from the problem that I did talk about to a more general version where we're talking about root graphs. Hard is online to talk about why. There are some results, but they don't have the same tightness about properties as the first case that I talked about.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
I do have to add some constraints to the energy progress of the system.
You're asking me? Do we have to add constraints?
For the progress, so what about the progress of the system? That's the question.
What about the?
So maybe one run would be that one agent gets all the events and the other agents just stay there.
This is kind of addressed in the results. The results make statements about the kind of graphs which are counted, and those graphs in particular have the implicit, I won't go into the details, is implicit in this is that every agent updates every so often, that they don't just sit there. Remember there were bounds on the times between, the distance between two event times of one agent. That kind of guarantees that nobody's going to be up on here for the next 3 weeks. Everybody's going to every so often update. But that's important.
But that's classical in the business, right? Eventually you need everybody to be updated differently often.
That's right.
Otherwise it cannot happen.
That's right. That's right. Do any of you know anything about the adaptive control literature?
Yeah.
Okay, so I last week I was in Santa Barbara and I spoke with Peter Kakovich and he pointed out that the so one of the conditions which arises in the basic sectors of this problem is the main theorem says that look, you don't really have to have a connectivity between rooted graphs at any instant of time, so long as the composition of the rooted graphs over some finite set of times is rooted. That's called jointly rooted. And then you want that to repeat itself in the term that I use is repeated jointly rooted. And he said that's nothing more, if he uses his term, than with a persistent excitation.
I don't think it's fair to call it nothing more.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of things. But it's obvious there's a connection.
It's obvious to say that it should be something like that because of what Darman said. We know from general principles that you have to see the synchronous algorithm. If you don't visit frequently enough, whatever that means in a particular situation, you cannot get convergence. But what means frequently enough in a particular instance is usually difficult to get. Obviously, get the weakest possible statement of that condition.
Question, we're just talking about convergence. Any rate is enough of revisiting, as long as you've actually converged. But the question, how often do you revisit? I mean, there are beautiful questions in the, if you have the guts, I don't know, if you have the strength, if you use the right word, to get into the connection between the structure of these graphs and convergence, they're hard. The last couple of days, we've been discussing this. These are
the effect of
characters. Not possible.
Any other questions? Right. Thank you. The one time there will be the usual round table at 2:00 in the new conference room in the center. Thank you for coming again.